All right, so again, it looks like we've got 8 members here, so we're going to go ahead and call the committee to order. Dr. Birkins, if you can let the minutes reflect that we have Mr. Pennings present, Mr. Moore, Mr. Laster, I am present, Mr. Morrison is present, Mr. Beaver, Ms. Powers, and Mr. Dudley are all present. And with that, you all received an agenda. It's a pretty generic agenda at this time. Does anybody have any changes to the agenda, though? All right, is there a motion to approve the agenda?
So moved.
All right, motion by Mr. Penning, second by Mr. Moore. Any discussion on the motion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. All right, you all received a draft set of minutes that you all received before today. Did anybody have any changes to the amendment, to the minutes, excuse me? And I know, Dr. Birkins, there's one item that needs to be changed. There's a comment that needs to be removed from the minutes, so in the draft that we received. Are there any additional changes? All right, seeing none, is there a motion to approve the minutes? Motion by Mr. Dudley. Second by Mr. Pennings. Any discussion on the motion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. All right. So again, I want to thank everyone for coming to this year's budget committee. As we get started today, I just kind of give everybody an overview of the process that we're going to do today and going forward. Today is just going to be an overview. We're going to review the requests that the director's making. We're also kind of going to view what our current situation is financially. And we're not going to be making any changes today. Again, today is just to go through the requests and make sure everyone understands the request today. And so we're going to be in kind of a work session type format. Later on, as we come back as a committee, we'll start acting a little bit more formal. We'll start taking up motions to either add or subtract from the requests that we have. And just so the board, or the committee, excuse me, has an idea of the schedule going forward as well as the public, over the next 2 weeks, we're going to take up the general purpose budget. So we've got 2 weeks that we're going to allocate to take as much time as we need. We've scheduled several meetings, but if we needed to do some additional meetings, we'll do that as well. But we're going to go through the general purpose budget these next 2 weeks of April and concentrate on that and hopefully tentatively approve a general purpose budget at the end of that process. Then the third week of April, we're going to take up our capital budget as well as our food budget and our federal budget. We'll take that up in the third week of April. And then the last week of April, we will look at it as all the budgets as a full board for final approval. And I do want to also mention that my hope is, we've got several meetings scheduled. My hope is each one of the meetings that we limit, try to pace ourselves, we're going to limit the meetings to 2 hours if possible. That's a goal. And we're hoping that all the meetings that we've scheduled are not necessary, that we'll be able to finish up the process a little bit early. So that's always our goal. But I want all the board member, or excuse me, all the committee members to feel like, feel that they have an opportunity to understand the budget. And so we'll take as much time as necessary to get through this process. Now today, again, this is the overview session. So what we'll do, we're going to break this up into 2 parts. The first part we're going to take up with Dr. Birkins, and Dr. Birkins is going to help us understand what our starting point is. What is our starting point as far as anticipated revenues? What's our starting point as far as anticipated expenditures if we don't make any changes, just kind of leave things pretty much as is? And then once we know kind of what our starting point is or have an understanding of that, we're going to then turn it over to Dr. Marzak, and we're going to go through his key request, and he's broken down his budget requests to coincide for each one of the keys that the director is focusing on to try to implement throughout our district. So again, we're going to go through that as an overview type thing. This is not a session to add and subtract at this moment, but everybody, as they're going through it, may want to take notes, and then at a later meeting, we'll come back, and if somebody wants to move to add things or to subtract things, we'll take those up in that later process. But today, my hope is when we get finished that all the committee members will have a good understanding of what our situation is and what the requests are so that we then have a template for going forward on the process of figuring all these things out, how this put all these jigsaw puzzles together. So with that, Dr. Birkins, first I'm going to kind of take up some things with you as far as our starting point. And you all sent us a spreadsheet that kind of gave us a breakdown of our revenue situation and our expenditure situation. And I'm just going to kind of break go in kind of two parts to that. Of course, the first part of any budget is dealing with revenue, what our anticipated revenue is. And this is the year 2016-17. We're having to kind of predict the future a little bit. And of course, we'll look at the past to be able to try to make some predictions about the future. But Dr. Birkins, it looks like for total revenue for 2016 through 2017, you're anticipating using a figure of $87.5 million. Is that correct for our general purpose budget?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay, and so that would be actually an increase from our 2015-16 budget of roughly around $1.7 million, and we can all see that on the screen. And I think everybody also received some information prior to today. Now, the additional funds, Dr. Birkins, maybe you can give the committee a little bit better understanding of why you're thinking that is a safe estimate to anticipate for revenues in the year 2016 through 17 budget.
The monies that we have received for the past year from sales tax revenue has increased at a steady pace, so we expect that it's going to increase at the same pace. That's what most of the increase is. It's all about sales tax revenue.
And looking, Dr. Birkins, at the revenue picture, it looks like for actual revenues in the budget year 14 through 15, you're showing that our actual revenues was around $86.6 million. Is that correct?
Yes.
But now for your estimate for the year 15-16, the current fiscal year that we're in, you're anticipating that the revenue is around going to be around $88.4 million.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yes.
So the budget item that you're using as a starting point, and again, this is a starting point. At some point, the committee may take this up and may not agree with you. They may think that the starting point it actually should be smaller, but this is kind of our starting point for this process.
For me, I started with the actual revenues from last year and use them as a guide, plus our historical data that we went over previously.
Okay. So I guess there is some conservative basis that the actual revenue, or what you're estimating the actual revenues to be for this fiscal year, you're actually the starting point as far as a budget standpoint is actually less than what we anticipate to be actual revenues.
Yes, trying to be conservative.
Okay. And I think we were talking today as we're looking at some of those revenues, it could be much more than that as far as the actual revenues.
Yes.
We're just having to try to figure out an estimate for that.
Yes.
Is that correct?
And I want it to be as safe as I could. I want it to be as reasonable as I could predict.
Okay. Now, another thing, as far as the revenues go, this does not include any budget increases from the state. At this juncture, we do not know what those numbers may or may not be. Is that
right?
Yeah, that's correct. Under Governor Haslam's new BEP initiative, as far as influxing whatever the state funds as far as BEP, we're slated to tentatively receive $3.5 million, which is to be used for teacher salaries, insurance purposes, leftover amounts for technology. But we don't know exactly what that figure is going to be yet. Nobody in the state knows. So they've just said you're tentatively going to get, but don't make that. That's not a hard number, so don't count on that. But you will be getting more. We will be getting more money next year for teacher salaries. And what I've told the county commission is there's no local matching dollars. This is a straight BEP influx. So the state's about 60-something percent. That's going to go up to like 64-65% or so of what they're going to fund. So there's no matching amount.
But you all are, I guess, staying in tune with the state. As we get more definite numbers, you all will update us on that.
Yes.
Which may come in at the time we get done with this process. We may get some more concrete information on that. But what we're looking at right now does not include any type of anticipated increase in BEP funding. Is that
no,
correct?
No, it does not.
Okay.
I am told that around the 15th of April, we usually receive those documents letting us know what the BEP funds are going to be.
Okay. All right. Now, I'm going to open the floor for questions of the committee in a moment, but I want to just kind of get through the big picture first, and then we'll come back and see what questions that the committee members may have. As far as expenditures, if you want to scroll down, It's my understanding that your office has actually gone through our existing budgets, and you all have found some actual, where you feel like we can make some savings in our current budget, is that correct?
Yes.
Now, what you're showing in the most updated spreadsheet that we have is that you all have found about $325,000 in savings in our current budget.
Yes.
Okay. Now, I think previously there was a different number, and I had you all go back and look at that some more to make sure that we're certain on that. With this $325,000 figure, we're certain that that is the savings.
Yes.
Okay. Because we don't, I think we all may have got a little tickled there, excited there for a moment. But okay, so so the net is, if my math is correct, if we used, Dr. Birkins, if we used your number of anticipated revenue, and if we used the savings expenditures and we just left everything else as is, that would be a net difference of around $1.7 million, I think. $1,728,000, is that correct?
For the total difference?
For the 16-17 school year that we're looking at, if we took the, and somebody can check my math, if we took the anticipated revenue of the $87.5 million and we subtracted that from the $85.7 million figure in expenditures, that would be a net remaining of $1.728,18693.
Trying to figure it in my head.
And I came close to bringing my big calculator today. I thought I could start punching numbers and hearing the paper turn.
$1.720, is that what you said? 184?
$1,728,000 and some change. Okay. So that would be kind of our, if we use these numbers, Dr. Birkins, my understanding is if we use these numbers, that would be some additional funding that we could apply towards some of the director's key requests that we're about to get into in a moment. And Dr. Marzak, you've already listed as far as your key request. Mm-hmm. These are things that you've currently put in what your budget request is, and we're actually going to go over some other things that could actually increase, but mm-hmm. kind of the starting point. Your request is around the $5 million figure.
Close,
correct?
Yes, yeah.
So even if we use that number, the $5 million, and then if we subtracted out the 1.7 and difference between revenue, anticipated revenue and anticipated expenditures,
yeah.
I think that number may be off a little bit. I think it's actually about $3.3 million would be the total increase that we would have to figure out how to do, figure out what to do with that.
Exactly.
Either, I guess the committee is going to have some decisions to make. Either we could increase requested or anticipated revenue. We could reduce some of these other expenditures. Mm-hmm. We could look at fund balance, or we could just turn you down. So I guess So we got some different options that we can go through, but that's kind of gives us kind of our starting point where we know when we start looking at your request, how that affects the bottom line.
Yes.
And so that the committee can then start making some intelligent decisions about yay or nay.
Where do we go? So. Exactly.
Okay, so with that, just going through some of the big picture, well, I guess there's one more big picture item, Dr. Birkins. As far as what you anticipate being in fund balance at the end of this fiscal year and the start of 16-17, you're thinking that we will roughly have starting about $6.3 million in fund balance, is
yes,
that correct?
Sir. Yes.
Okay. Now, you've discussed with me that you're looking at some other things that actually might increase a little bit, but not in a substantial amount, I guess.
Correct.
As far as what the fund balance may
Correct.
Be. So that's kind of our nest egg, so to speak, from our savings of when we start looking at some of the director's requests, do we want to use some of those funds for some one-time expenditures if we can? So we'll be taking a look at that. But now, the state says that we have to always keep at least 3% of what our budget expenditures are. We have to keep at least that much.
Yes.
As a cushion, kind of a rainy day fund at all times. So it's not as though we can raid the full amount, I guess. And you've actually, you've done a 3% test. So you're showing a balance. And you've also, under 1617, you're also, I guess, making some assumptions about there may be some increases of fund balance that fiscal year. Maybe you all may have to explain. I get a little bit lost in the weeds and all that, so you all may be able to explain some of that as we get a little bit closer to those discussions. But so with that, so we've kind of gone over some of the big picture items, Dr. Berkins, and what I'm going to do is open the floor to the committee to see if they have any questions regarding what you've laid out as far as anticipated, a base anticipated revenue and anticipated expenditures.
Okay. Can I start with letting you know the pages in your notebook that you were given, they're a breakdown of each one of those categories that are on this document here. So if you really want to look and see what each line item is, it's available in these pages, as well as a description of what that is.
Thank you, Dr. Birkin. So in the notebook that the committee members have received, you've gone through and kind of it pulls out each one of these chart of accounts that the state says we have to use these accounts and sub-accounts. You've gone through and given a description of each one of those subcategories, what that is, for the board members to be able to review if they want some additional information.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right, so again, I'm going to open the floor, see if any committee members have any questions, and once we get through that, we'll take up the director's budget. All right, seeing none, Dr. Marzak, we're ready to proceed with your proposed budget request.
Okay.
And
the keys are in the back pocket of your notebook, the very back pocket. I wanted to make them easily accessible.
Okay. And Dr. Marzak, this might be a good, maybe introduction for everyone, just to remind everyone, the process that you went through to arrive at this point. Maybe kind of give us a little bit of the background of each individual school's putting together budgets, coming to you, and how that ended up resulting in this, and then we'll get into the details of this.
10-4. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So so if you guys remember, what we did from October to December is we polled, you know, 46 different constituency groups and asked them, what should our students know and be able to do at all three levels, elementary, middle school, and high school? We took that data, and we formulated our seven keys to college and career readiness. So in January, what the principals were given their current performance according to the keys that they're responsible for. So all elementary schools got their performance according to keys 1 and 2, all middle schools, key 3 and 4, and all high schools, key 5, 6, and 7. Principals then went back to their schools, met with their leadership teams, looked at the data, and asked the question, what do we need to do in order to improve our performance on the keys? Or what do we need to do to make sure that more kids are reading at grade level, more kids are doing Algebra 1 by the end of 8th grade? What do we need to do? And so the teachers and the principals brainstormed and strategized things that they could implement at their school to impact the keys. And if there was a cost associated with it, then the principals brought that back before the budget meetings that we had at the end of February. So at the end of February, in 1 week, we met with all 22 schools, and they gave us their key requests according to the budget. So we had their scorecards up in the budget meeting, and it was basically, if the data didn't show that it was necessary, then it didn't make the keys budget that you see here, because obviously they're doing well. So what you're seeing here and what you see in your folder are a list of the requests from the schools according to what they need to meet their keys to college and career readiness. You have your first column, which is your maintain. This is a column where principals said, these are the things that we need to move forward. These are things that we need to be put in place. Your next column is your accelerate column. Accelerate is what we would like to have, but it's not a deal breaker if we don't get it. It's that pie in the sky, if you will. And then what we did is, as a central office, as an executive team, we created a third column that says funded. So if, according to the data, if we saw that as critical and we agreed with the principal, we went ahead and moved that out of either the maintain or the accelerate and moved it into the funded line item. And so this budget doc that you see is broken down by all of the seven keys. There's also an all keys. There may have been something that the school was asking for that didn't hit just one key. It hit multiple keys. So as opposed to going in one and only impacting one, it impacts all of them. You'll also see that there is a technology request in order to line us up to be even closer to one-to-one moving forward next year. There's also a maintenance and operation request, which is kind of like spurned on from the EMG assessment that was conducted, as well as feedback from LeanFrog for Mr. Breeden about what it's going to take to really start to chip away at that EMG assessment, and as far as the way your department is organized.
So, and just so the committee knows, we're going to go through each one of these keys kind of piece by piece and understand what it is that we're trying to accomplish and what those individual budget requests are.
Exactly.
But just so the board members kind of understand the big picture, and we're about to get into the details of all this. So, Dr. Marzak, after meeting with all the principals, they were telling you, okay, as far as key number one, this is where I think I can make an impact. And they
exactly.
were making those requests. And so some of those requests you've already moved from the maintain or the accelerate
yes.
column, and you've already moved it in what you call a budgeted column, which is orange.
Exactly. Okay. Exactly. Like, take, for example, line number 9. So both Baker and McDowell Elementary School asked for an RTI teacher that would meet with kids and intervene in order to help them learn how to read better according to key number 1. You'll notice as you move down, it was a large request from each and every individual school. So I felt moving forward in year 1, if we could do part-time positions at each where they split a school, let's see how they do, and then let's determine next year if we want to split those out and make sure that Baker has one and McDowell has one. So let's gather the data first before we hire 2 personnel. Let's hire 1 personnel and assign them to both schools. And because Baker and McDowell are closely, they're both elementary schools and they're geographically close, it would be a seamless transition to work between the two. So that's an example of something, I think that's something critical that Baker and McDowell would benefit from. I think it would impact their keys. So it went into the orange column from the blue column.
And so in the orange column, those are the things that you have identified as the director as being critical enough that's already on the budget request.
Now, with feedback from my team, yes.
Right. Now, as the committee, as we start going through the process, we can look at the items in the gray column or the yellow column, and
yes.
we'll be able to make a decision, do we want to, instead of having those left out of that orange column, whether we move that into the orange column as being that's going to be funded.
Yes. For example, now, as a board, you guys could decide to split that up and make that 2 separate positions. One teacher at Baker, 1 teacher at McDowell. That's a decision that you can make.
Okay. And, of course, the board, as a committee, we could go through the orange column, and we could, I guess, on your individual request, we could actually take some of those items out.
Yes, you could.
But now, if we kind of just where the board or the committee can see the big picture first, if you'll scroll down as far as the orange column, if you'll go all the way to the bottom line. All right,
not there. There we go.
So the bottom line of the additional request that you're already currently requesting that we approve is about $4.9 million. There's the
yes.
total amount of all those items in orange.
Yes.
And so again, going back to the big picture, okay, so if we approve all of that, then we got to go back to Dr. Birkin's picture again. And
yes.
we've got to figure out some things. We've got to figure out the revenue, because we only have about 1.7, so we got to figure out something on revenue. We
mm-hmm.
got to figure out something on more savings and expenditures or fund balance. So we got to go back and kind of juggle that process. And that being said, if we then also move things from the gray or the yellow column into the orange column, that's going to increase that.
Yes.
So there's going to be a little bit more juggling,
yes.
I guess, as far as that process.
Exactly.
So I think now that the committee kind of has just a big picture view of kind of what the bottom line could be and how that's going to affect, let's go back to key number 1. And what I think we'll do, we're just going to tackle 1 key at a time. And Dr. Marzak, what I'd like for you to do is just go through, and some of these things you may be able to group together. I don't know, you know,
mm-hmm.
you may not have to go through every RTI teacher. That may be something where you're able to explain to us.
Yeah.
What is the significance of that you're trying to address? And then as you're going through this key number one, if you can explain to the committee why you put some things already in orange, mm-hmm. and why some things are still in the gray column and some things are in the yellow column, so that the committee can get enough information where we can then get into discussions later on about whether things get moved into the orange or mm-hmm. things get moved out of the orange. So, but first, remind us, what is key number one? What are we trying to accomplish with key number one?
All students reading at grade level by the end of third grade.
Okay. So this is reading and third grade. All right, so if you can just walk us through and give us an understanding of those requests as it relates to third grade reading and why some things are in orange and some things are in yellow. And once we get through that, as far as you explaining all that to us, we'll pause and I'm going to open it for questions of the committee.
Sure.
And then we'll go to the next key. So we'll just keep going through that process till we all have a good understanding of what the requests are.
Sure. So one of the first things that both Baker and McDowell, like I said, asked for was an RTI teacher, somebody to work with kids. I saw that as that's a good strategy. If you're going to impact, it would also be easily trackable on a scorecard, because as you work with students through RTI, their AIMSWeb scores should be improving. And as far as RTI, they're in three tiers. Tier one is general classroom instruction. Tier two is more localized help, and tier three is severe help. So if we have students that are in tier three, you want to get them to tier two. They're in two tier, you want to get them back into tier one, which is general classroom instruction, and then the RTI teacher doesn't work with them anymore. So that would be easily trackable. So I saw that as a high leverage strategy that could both work at Baker and McDowell. And I do see those things as working out throughout the course of the year. Baker also asked for part-time teaching assistants. I felt I'd like to see how the teacher works out themselves individually versus having additional people in there as well. That may be something we look at in the future. If a half person is doing a good job, how much could a whole person or a person and a half do? How much could they crank out? And so that's one of the things why we left also in the maintain and two people in the accelerate column. Baker had asked for a copy machine for instructional materials. We had looked at possibly using current funds to see if we could get that funded without it going through the keys. But we would also want to ask a little bit more carefully, what type of instructional materials are you looking to copy? If it's worksheets, we're not really into that. If it's materials to specifically address learning gaps and specific tools, such as copying materials for students to have something to read, then that's a little bit different. Moving down to Spring Hill Elementary School, again, they asked for full-time teacher assistants to help out in the classroom. A lot of the schools, which you'll see according to line number 13, they asked for Chromebooks. They want to replace current desktop computers that are in the classroom that are kind of antiquated, slow, and old. And we also saw Chromebooks as a good alternative, because you could either work in a station or you could take that to your desk and work on it, because it's a, like I said, it's a web-based laptop. So it's easily movable around the classroom. They had asked for $575. That's quite a large cost. And all the schools that asked for Chromebooks, we were able to fund, I believe we were able to fund 25 at $12,500 for the entire school. So, but of course, that can also be increased if you would like to do that. Spring Hill Elementary School also asked for an instructional coach, somebody to work with the teachers, and they asked for an RTI teacher. So we felt that it was a greater investment to work through that RTI teacher again, sharing with Marvin Wright in the Spring Hill section to see how they do, kind of like Baker and McDowell, moving kids from Tier 3 to Tier 2 to Tier 1. Mount Pleasant Elementary School asked for an RTI full-time teacher assistant, and they also asked for an elementary kindergarten teacher to reduce numbers. Those are currently left in the maintain and the accelerate column, because as we move on down, I'd have to get down to see if Mount Pleasant was paired up with another school, and I think they are for mathematics. So we'll get down there. But right now, those two are still sitting with concerns to key number one. McDowell Elementary School asked for one first grade teacher, kind of like the kindergarten teacher that was asked for at Mount Pleasant Elementary School. And I'll go back up because I just realized I skipped numbers. So that's still current sitting in the accelerate column. Leveled readers were asked for by a school. And so in a conversation that we had, Mr. Gaines and I, is if we do leveled readers for one school, it would be fair that we just did leveled readers for all schools. And so what leveled readers are, according to where your current Fountas and Pinnell or your Lexile level is, there are certain books that are specifically on your reading level that can help you push you further with reading. So we felt that that would be a good purchase for all elementary schools. And in talking with teachers, they were agreeable to that. They were like, yes, we need more leveled readers to address more learning styles of, and reading levels of more kids. Mount Pleasant Elementary School, there's a Chromebook request, and Chromebook request is funded. Mount Pleasant Elementary School asked for an interactive projection board for their lab. They currently don't have it. But the interim principal, who's now the current principal, saw that as something that needed to go in the Accelerate line item. That'd be great if we had it, but if we don't, it's okay. It's not a problem. I already talked about McDowell Elementary School with a first grade teacher to overload. They want smaller numbers. At Marvin Wright, they also asked for Chromebooks to work with Mion, MobiMax, and Spire, which are reading programs that they currently have at the school. So that's been funded at $12,500. Couldn't get them 168, but we got them as many as we could. And also remember, with that BEP overage, there's going to be some more money for technology. So we may be able to supply some more more Chromebooks to schools on the back end. Riverside asked for Asus tablets for students to access Mion. That's currently sitting at $3,000 because we did later on down, we were able to give them some Chromebooks, which they'll be able to take in and around the building. At Brown Elementary School, they asked for a kindergarten teacher to relieve numbers to go to lower class sizes. That's currently sitting in Accelerate according to the recommendation of the principal. However, they did ask for a 120-day contract for a teacher to work with students at a cost of $38,000, and we thought that was a good use of funds to bring somebody in, an experienced educator, on 120 days to work with students to move them from Tier 3 to Tier 2 to Tier 1. Both Woodard and Mount Pleasant Middle School had asked for an RTI interventionist. Mount Pleasant was up around key number 3. So considering the location of the two, these were the two that were closest in proximity that could benefit from an RTI teacher. So that's why those two were put together. Woodard asked for money for a kindergarten readiness boot camp. That's currently sitting in the Accelerate Fund based on what the principal recommended. I would like to have it, but it's not critical. We may be able to find current funding in our current money in order to fund that. So it's sitting in the Accelerate column. Woodard also asked for summer remediation, so two contracted positions, teachers that would come in and get kids caught up during the summer. And again, that would be easily trackable. We'd pre-test and post-test the students to show how they to show their growth and how they did. Santa Fe asked for part-time reading teacher assistants. That's still sitting in the maintain column as the other teacher assistants are. As we move on down, they were approved to have an RTI teacher. They also asked for 70 hours of tutoring for after school for key number 1. That's sitting in the Accelerate column. Randolph Howell and Highland Park both asked for a reading intervention teacher. So that split is sitting in the funded column based on their current data. They both need it. At Randolph Howell, they also asked for a kindergarten teacher to bring down class sizes. And in Highland Park, they asked for the exact same thing, but the grade to be determined. But as both principals said, those weren't deal breakers, so those can sit in the Accelerate column. Highland Park asked for literacy materials, but we figured with the leveled readers, then that would satisfy the cost for those literacy materials. So they're included in the line above. They also asked for Chromebooks for Mion, and that was funded. And Culioca Unit School asked to implement the Fountas and Pinnell K-4 assessment program at a cost of $7,800. And based on their Key 1 data, we saw that as something that needed to be funded.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Barzak.
You're welcome.
All right, so what we're going to do, we're just going to take a breather, and I'm going to open the floor to the committee to see if anybody has any questions regarding those requests as it relates to key number 1. Okay. Mr. Lassiter and then Ms. Powers.
On the splits for the elementary schools for RTI.
Yes.
How do you see that split working?
This
one day at one school, one day at the next, or 50-50 each day, or what did you have in mind there?
Well, based on the principals at Baker and McGavick and McDowell, based on the principals would get together and decide how they want to split that out. We would fund the position. They would determine the split. So it's completely up to them about how they want to do it. It could be 5 days at one school, 5 days at another school. It could be morning, afternoon. It could be 3 and 2, switch to 2 and 3. It's completely up to the principals how they want to do it.
Okay, because I know one problem that with the traveling teachers like this for Reach for Gifted programs, let's say, if your school's on a Monday, you're hurting because
yes.
we have so many Monday holidays, the kids miss out on a tremendous amount.
Yes.
And, okay, so I understand the principals are going to work out the timeshare part of it.
Mm-hmm.
How are we going to ensure that the students that need covered can get covered in that 50% of the time?
It's what the principals are going to have to work out. The, like I said, originally, these were split out individually. So Baker was getting one, and McDowell Elementary School was getting one. So that would have been $130,000 for both schools. So if you split these out, that impact cost rises about $400,000 to $500,000, which then impacts your bottom line, which means less gets funded in certain areas.
And the $65,000 comes from
that's about
salaries.
That's about the cost of a teacher, salary, benefits, and everything.
Okay. All right. And I see some benefits to doing the leveled reader, but mm-hmm. I thought that's also why we were doing the MION program, was to use that as a leveled reading program.
Mm-hmm.
And so is there a reason we're going to go to more hard copy and MION both?
It's just, it's an influx of literacy materials. The leveled readers are in lieu of buying a Basel textbook delivered from a publisher that directs what you teach, how you teach, and when you teach. So these are more resources in the classroom. They give kids more access to print. That's the request that came from the principals. We need as much print as we can get. And print on computer is still print. But their request is we need as much as we can possibly get.
So the literacy program on here is going to be electronic, not?
Which literacy program?
Let's see.
Are you talking about Fountas and Pinnell K-4 assessment?
No, before that there was the leveled readers.
You're talking these are books.
Okay,
that are
physical,
about kid size,
physically printed, okay.
physical books,
I mean,
and
I've
they're.
I've seen what we used to use. I just didn't know if we were going.
Yeah, and they may have like 10, 11, 12 pages.
Right,
and the text on the page is based on the complexity of the
right.
reading level.
I just didn't know if we were going electronic or if we were going. And that's where my question kind of was dealing with that. Would the leveled readers be that? And you answered the question, but I didn't know if we were going electronic or we were going printed material. And if we were going to go electronic, why we weren't just mm-hmm. using MION.
We're going both.
All right. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Did I understand that one RTI specialist is going to be split between Woodard Elementary and Mount Pleasant Middle?
Yes. Geographically, that's the best I could do.
Well, I do agree geographically, but is the kind of non-student prep time, you know, if it's elementary to elementary, isn't it kind of one amount of research that's kind of duplicated, where when you've got elementary and middle, is that not one
we have,
person?
Yeah, well, two things on that. We have middle school students are still reading on an elementary level, and the request under key number one, there is an odd number of elementary schools. And so that's why the pairing came up between Woodard and Mount Pleasant Middle School, is because if we didn't pair it that way, then one school would have a full purchase while everybody else had half purchases.
Well, that kind of leads into my second question,
mm-hmm.
when the way you're putting it as a purchase, and I'm following your rationale, but I see so much value in job share or part-time,
mm-hmm.
because then we don't pay benefits. And I think there are a sizable number of teachers that are good teachers that aren't burned out, that are, you know, have either young families or, you know, and they've got insurance and other sources. So I would love to see some of these RTI positions be open as part-time and save us insurance and benefits.
Mm-hmm.
Is this something we've considered?
We could do it. And that's, if that's a way you want to go, then what we can do is we can break these out and make them all job share positions and part-time positions, and we look for people.
I think it should, well.
We can do that if that's what you guys want to do.
Well, I'm glad that y'all are the ones that get to make these decisions, but I think that should be considered an option.
Yes.
And it could save us money and still get us quality.
Well, look, for example, like at Baker and McDowell, so if you split $65,000 in half, that's about 30, no, that's about 20, what's 65,000 and a half? My mental math. I didn't go through Common Core. So 32.5. So Baker and McDowell could agree to take that 32.5 and hire a part-time person. And that part-time person just works at just their school, if that's something they want to agree to. So basically, when you look at this amount, we're allotting 65,000 to Baker and McDowell. Here's your 65,000. How you want to spend it, how you want to split it, how you want to mark it up, it's completely up to you. You're accountable under your scorecard because you asked for it and it was funded. But how you want to split up and do it, it's completely up to you, principals. It's your call. And that could be an option. Your call.
Mr. Pennings.
I understand where Ms. Powers is coming from. But you take a part-time person.
Mm-hmm.
Because she has a small one. And all of a sudden they say, well, geez, this school district offered me a $20,000 raise if I go full-time.
Mm-hmm.
I think full-time with benefits are a lot easier to hold on to.
Yes, they are.
Than a part-timer. And I'm talking about that from experience where I work out. It works out with the part-time people. You come and get a part-time job, excuse me, 90% of those people are looking for a full-time job, and as soon as they find a good one, they're gone.
Mm-hmm. True.
But I agree with what you say, Ms. Powers.
Okay. So that's all very good discussion, and I would ask all the committee members, as we're going through some of these things, make good notes, because in future committee meetings, we're going to then start taking up these items, and mm-hmm. committee's going to be asked. Okay, you see what's in the orange column. Does anybody want to move anything out? They're going
exactly.
to have to make a motion. We'll take it out, and we'll go through. Then we'll go through the gray columns, see if anybody wants to move anything over into orange. Again, understanding how that's going to affect the bottom line. So I would suggest everyone to try to keep good notes. And if there are some proposals that you think that may be a little bit better for the school system, I wouldn't hesitate to get with the director on some of those things, and maybe there can be a little bit of discussion in advance so that when we take up some of those motions, we can do it in the best possible manner that is going to work the best. Mr. Moore.
On these RTI positions, I'm sort mm-hmm. of this, again, I'm having to transition to this model. The principals would be hiring them, open to doing whatever hiring they're doing, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Are we seeking out people that have specific experience in RTI at that point, or are we just hiring a teacher?
We could build that into the job description. You know, must be knowledgeable with RTI, must have the ability to work, must love reading or must love math. You know, we could build certain things into to make sure we're looking for the right person. Because you're right, it's all in the hiring process.
Well, I mean, I think some of this may go with what I think Ms. Powers was saying a little bit, and where I was probably thinking she was going. I wasn't envisioning splitting the 65.5 or 65,000 in half. Generally speaking, when you're hiring a part-time person, it's going to be less expensive because you don't have the benefits.
Sure.
I think probably, and maybe I'm speaking for her, I was expanding that, taking that 4 schools worth of 65,000 and being able to spread that out further.
Mm-hmm.
Because you've got the benefits spread there. But I think with that, again, looking for the maximum, I guess, impact here, I would like to see not only exploring an option like that, as well as looking at making sure we're hiring people that have a specific skill set in RTI.
Yes.
I really want to make sure we're getting people that are not just another teacher, or not, especially not just a young teacher that's just getting started. Not that there's anything wrong with young teachers getting started.
Yeah.
But if we're really wanting impact on something like this, that seems like that would be a natural something we'd be seeking out, is maximizing the someone who has experience with RTI that can really give us a good impact.
And don't forget, all of these get scorecarded. So we look at the progress of students over time, and then the conversation takes place. So maybe we go through, we get, you know, Randolph Howell and Highland Park funded at half. We get around to December, the progress is so-so or not very good, And, you know, well, this person's part-time. Sometimes they're not able to make it. They've got a young kid. They've missed meeting with kids. You know, that's part of the, okay, so we look to funding it full-time next year. Where do you think you'll get to by May? And so all of this stuff basically informs conversation about how students are growing, how many students are growing, how fast they're growing. As you know, and as the rest of you guys know, time and money. That's, we're all constrained by that. So this is just the starting point. This is year one with the keys as we start to dip our toe in the water to figure out what we're doing to systematically and systemically improve outcomes in Maury County schools.
Well, I guess the only thing, and I guess this kind of ties into what Mr. Laster said as well. I know this is the first year, but
yeah.
I think there's a lot of things we could probably, or we, the people that are making decisions could really spend some extra time talking through on the front end and probably save themselves a whole lot of guessing at the six-month mark.
Sure.
Such as what Mr. Laster said about the Mondays being a scheduled day off all the time. If you look at scheduling that, if someone doesn't just happen to pay attention to that, one person could really get shortchanged. Or let me say that one school, which means a lot of students are going to get shortchanged on
good
that.
Point.
So, I mean, those are kind of things that I know we may be a little belaboring, but I would really hope that those kind of thought processes would go into these decisions to make sure that we're not figuring those out on the back end that we
yep.
could have easily figured out on the front end.
Good point.
I think I might be stepping over the boundary of what you've asked, but I'm so sorry I have to take this opportunity because I really do feel strongly about this, that there's a huge volume of either teachers that don't want to work full-time anymore, and I do understand that a lot of people do need full-time, and they are going to get their foot in the door with part-time for an opportunity for full-time. But I think there's a huge segment that if we could market this for what it is, and there has been a huge success in job share in this county. The previous administration, like, pulled the plug. There were, at McDowell, there were two teachers that intentionally job shared. If one was out with a sick kid, the other one knew that it was their responsibility to step in. Go back and check the record. There was never one sub hired. There was total continuity. There was no sub pay. It was good for the kids. So I think you've got to market it to a certain population, but I think that is a huge cost savings and benefit to our county. When you start talking about reduction in subs, continuity for the kids, this is good for kids. It needs to be marketed well. But Mr. Gaines, you were here and aware of the situation at McDowell. Was it a success? Okay. People who've been removed from our administration chose to remove that situation, but it was good for kids. So thank you for allowing me that opportunity.
Thank you again, Ms. Powers. All right, any other questions regarding key number one requests? All right, seeing none, Dr. Marzak, looks like we're ready to move into key number two. And so refresh our recollection, what is key number two? What are we trying to accomplish?
Students completing math on grade level by the end of fourth grade. So when principals came and presented to us, so moving on down the list, kind of like what we did with key one, so Baker asked for a part-time teacher assistant to work specifically, two part-time teacher assistants to work with students on mathematics. That still sits in the maintain column. Spring Hill Elementary School asked to implement a math intervention program in grades 2 through 4 called Classworks. That was moved over to the funded line. They also asked for a math intervention program for kindergarten and first grade called Moving with Math at a cost of $1,465. That was moved over into funded. Spring Hill Elementary School asked for an art teacher. We see the correlation and data was presented and research was presented on the correlation between arts and mathematics and how one influences the other. So we moved that over because Spring Hill Elementary School currently doesn't have an art teacher. So the students do not receive art on a daily basis. So that was moved over to funded. Mount Pleasant Elementary School asked for an RTI full-time teacher assistant with math. And they also asked for another elementary first grade teacher to reduce numbers to impact math. Those sit both in the accelerate column upon advice from the principal. Mount Pleasant Elementary School asked for a music and arts program. Again, that principal brought the data and the research to say that those both influence mathematics. So that was moved over to the funded column. Mount Pleasant Elementary School asked for also STEAM supplies, science, technology, engineering, arts, and mathematics. Supplies, that was moved over to funded at $4,298. Marvin Wright Elementary School currently doesn't have a music teacher. They presented data and research to show how music influences mathematics scores. So that was moved over to the funded line. They also asked for math interventionists, a teacher to work with students specifically on math. That currently sits still in the maintain column. Riverside asked for Chromebooks for Dreambox. You'll notice, you remember at the top, they asked for Asus tablets for Mion, but we instead funded 25 Chromebooks for Dreambox so that students can interact with our new math program. Woodard asked for a technology teacher and an academic coach to work with teachers. That currently sits in the accelerated column. Woodard also asked for money for a kindergarten readiness boot camp. That was moved into funded. They also asked for summer remediation, two contracted positions to work with specifically with students on math. That was moved to funded. Santa Fe asked for part-time math teacher assistants to work with kids. They asked for two. One sits in maintain and one sits in funded. So we moved one of those positions over and left one in the maintain column. They also asked for a mathematics computer instructor. That currently sits in the accelerate column. Randolph Howell asked for an RTI intervention teacher in math third and fourth grade specifically to work with students. That still sits in the maintain column. They also asked for Chromebooks. We were able to move 25 over. Hampshire Unit School asked for Chromebooks for students to work on Dreambox. That was funded over in the funded column. Highland Park asked for a technology teacher to specifically work with students on Dreambox. That sits in the accelerate column. And Highland Park also asked for STEM club supplies at a cost of $9,000, and that was moved into the funded column.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Marzak. Okay.
You're welcome.
So I'm going to open the floor again to see if anyone has any questions for Dr. Marzak regarding key number two. Mr. Lassiter.
I understand the idea of allowing a lot of autonomy by the principals to go through and the teachers and the teams to go through and pick some of this out. But I guess I'm still having problems getting used to the fact that, for example, if Mount Pleasant Elementary says they'd like to have STEAM supplies, wouldn't that be good to have that at all the schools? Or
that was only requested at Mount Pleasant and Highland Park.
And I understand, well, and Highland Park wanted STEM, did they not?
STEM supplies, yes.
Okay, so they didn't even ask necessarily for the art end of it, more for the, you know, the technology and engineering.
And if you want to, I can multiply that number by how many schools again? Elementary schools, 11, 12? I can multiply that number by 12 if you would like me to.
But and here's kind of where I'm going with this question.
Sure.
So if the four of you were all principals at different schools, and I go to your school first, and then I go to the next one, and I go to the next one, and if you guys haven't sat down amongst yourselves and your teachers amongst yourselves, maybe Randolph Howell, for example, didn't even think, wow, you know, we should be asking for STEAM supplies. And
or maybe they're not ready to implement STEAM. We don't know. Principals did see this as we sat down and worked with this. So you'll see that Baker was the first school in. And then after Baker, Spring Hill was in. Spring Hill saw what Baker asked for. But regardless, we could take line 45 and multiply 4298 times 13. We can do that.
And I understand that. And I would love to give them all the same opportunity. I don't want to do it and them not use the programs.
And that's the key thing.
That's what I like about the fact that they're making, you know, they're making their own decisions.
With the leveled readers, they will use those in balanced literacy in the classroom. STEAM supplies is a little different feature. You have to implement those STEAM activities in the classroom. The other teachers of the other schools may not be ready to do that yet.
So that's
a consideration.
When I look through this list, I mean, I'm trying to look through the list through the eyes of the students.
Yes.
Through the eyes of the parents who have students at the school and say, okay, if my child goes to this school, they're going to do STEAM. You know, they're going to do a STEAM program, but because my child goes to this elementary school over here, they're not doing STEAM. My child could use it, but we're not doing it. And I mean, I'm not saying this won't work, and I'm not, it's just harder for me to wrap my head around going and saying, all right, we're going to do programs, and, you know, we're going to do this one over here and not this one over here.
Yes.
Because it seems like we've been this way before in the past, and then at the end of the day, or at the end of the year, all the students need to be at about the same place to be on grade level.
And another thing I think you need to be prepared for, principals, much like teachers, much like parents, much like board members, much like central office personnel, we talk. And so Mount Pleasant Elementary School may rock through these STEAM supplies, and they start talking amongst one another, and then you've got 12 more schools that request STEAM supplies next year.
Right.
Because one of the things I do want to help you understand is students will be doing STEAM and STEM through project-based learning with Discovery Education. Behind PBL is STEM, STEAM, tech, all of those things. They're all a component of it, and they're all a project. They're all a part of it. So what Mount Pleasant is wanting to do, this may be a request from a third and a fourth grade teacher that has some research and some data that shows how STEAM integration affects math scores. And so while we see it here this year, you may see it at 10 more schools this request next year. Because according to Mount Pleasant Elementary School, they're ready to go now. Whereas Randolph Howell or Riverside may not be as ready now, but they will be ready eventually. Because like I said, it's a component of project-based learning.
And again, you know, when I look at it through the eyes of a student, next year is too late for the students that are there this year.
Yes, sir. And the fourth grade students that move on to middle school.
Right.
It's too late.
And that's my concern.
Understandable.
Is, you know, students missing opportunities that we can't make up.
Yes, sir.
So, all right.
Tough decisions.
Mr. Moore.
Just looking at two of them here, and again, I don't know how the process worked on these. You've got the Spring Hill Elementary School art teacher and then the music mm-hmm. art teacher at Mount Pleasant, and then Marvin Wright had a music teacher.
Yes.
I mean, how did this process work? Because I feel like those should be givens at every school.
Yes.
I mean, those shouldn't even be on this list in my book.
Yes.
They are in my book. But can you explain to me how that part works? Because I just want to make sure that a school that's asking for something like that, which is a pretty big thing,
yes.
if you look at it cost-wise, I just don't want to make sure that that school is not, again, just because Marvin Wright had looks like two requests here that are on here. One is in the, obviously covered, the music teacher, thank goodness,
mm-hmm.
And then math interventionalist. But I just want to make sure that, you know, a school like that, and I see there's a couple others, they're not kind of like giving up something they also wanted to ask for because they kind of asked for what I would consider a given. Does that make sense?
What you're seeing on this list are everything that the school has asked for that met in the data called for it.
Okay.
So, like, for example, we had Marvin Wright's math scores up according to key number two. Their requests were needed to meet key number two.
Okay. So they may have asked for other things, five other things, and in the process where you worked with that school, it was decided that they didn't meet a specific key and or they weren't ready for it or whatever reason there was.
And what I'd have to do is have to bring my notes to see exactly what we discussed. And
okay.
Because nothing,
no, I just mean
nothing
the process
was
here. I'm not talking about the specific.
Okay, gotcha.
The process would be that
if
you
anything,
guys went through with maybe five items. I'm just talking about
if anything wasn't added, it wasn't added at that meeting with the principal there.
Okay.
Everything you're seeing here is on the list as the principal left the meeting. Nothing was taken off after they left.
Okay. Again, my concern, I just want to make sure that the school doesn't feel like they kind of used up their wishes by asking for something that shouldn't have been a wish in the first place.
Good point. All right. Of course you can.
We did not limit their wishes. They came in with their budget. They all received their budget. They filled them out. And then they were allowed to tell us what they thought they needed to meet the keys. We didn't give them a dollar amount. We didn't give them a number. We didn't give them anything. We just let them go with it.
And let me say, I think this is kind of the model that I think we want to adopt going forward. I think probably historically institutions, they bought things and then they tried to figure out a plan afterwards, or tried to figure out how does this work within what our needs are.
Or try to push it on teachers and say, here, you have to do this right now.
Mr. Lizer, I certainly appreciate your comments, because that's something that I'm sensitive to as well, that we are going to try to treat everybody fairly, and that's in our vision statement, that we're going to educate every child for life. Mm-hmm. But to do that, you have to cultivate leadership within, I think, those individual schools so that they take the initiative to realize this is something that we need to address, and this is how our budget request gets us that means to an end. But I think sometimes, maybe historically, probably in a lot of institutions, it's been we just go ahead and throw money at something, and then there's a device that just sits there and collects dust. Everybody's got one. Everybody's got this wonderful device, but it's just collecting dust because nobody really had the initiative. It was just, hey, here's your device, and nobody really, you know, took that initiative to request it. So that's just my thoughts on that.
And it's true,
process.
Mr. Chairman, another way to look at this is not a top down, this is a bottom up. So this is not us telling the schools and the teachers what they need to do. This is the teachers in the school telling us what they need in order to be successful.
And two, this is the first year of the process. I do think there's probably going to be a little bit of a bandwagon type result in some of these things when some of the schools start seeing what the other schools are implementing and taking the initiative for. Everybody's going to want to get on the bandwagon and start taking those initiatives. But that's the key thing. I think that's almost like the most important first step, is that they see the need and they want to try to address it. Then it's almost like, I don't care what you give them. Then they already know that, hey, this is an urgent matter that we need to address. And you're almost, I think, 90% there. Then it's just a matter of providing the tools. So
and
more.
And the principals did tell us that they told the teachers, you know, whatever we ask for and we get, it's going to be scorecarded. So we get it, and they don't just walk away and say, have fun. They're going to be tracking our progress as far as students making academic progress with relation to this ask that's up here. So teachers and principals do know that there is accountability with the request and the grant from this body.
Okay. I guess to kind of go with what Mr. Lasser said, and I don't want to put words in his mouth, but from my view, and I think your point about top down versus bottom up, as a board member, I'm still looking to find that balance. I know this is a new process for us and for everybody here.
Yes.
And I see merit in some things being bottom up.
Mm-hmm.
But also I think sometimes as a board member, I would like to see and make sure that we're not too bottom up on all of these things. I don't want to be all over the place. It's kind of shotgun approach.
Mm-hmm.
And while some of them will work, and I understand that, the nature of that, if you go all the way to that direction, is that a lot of them won't work.
Yeah.
And then I'm looking for that balance, and I guess I'm asking you as the director to make sure that keep us this process explained as that there is a balance there. Because I would think, and I think some other board members have mentioned that too, that as we get to some of these things, like, for example, when I see something as art teacher or music teacher that should be a given, what I consider a given, that seems to be like something that should be probably a top-down decision that, hey, we're going to have these things at every school no matter what. But then there's other things that probably do need to be coming up from the bottom that are driven by a specific need, and I think that's a good thing. So I'm looking for that balance where we meet in the middle, where there's some top-down stuff, and you're laying that out for us, and then we're also getting the bottom-up stuff and getting the feedback on how that's working.
And so that's a request that you guys can make of us when we come back and we start to edit this document. I want you to pull those three off, and I want you to find current funding to make those happen. Take those out of the keys. You can tell us to do that, and we'll make it work. We'll find out a way to find the money to make it work. Something else may have to go away. We may have the funding. So you'll see as we get further on down, through budget adjustments and potential use of fund balance, where we're trying to make it work.
And I think it's a good point. This is not set in concrete.
No.
This is a starting point. You got to start somewhere.
Yes.
And so committee members can make adjustments if they want to, if they feel like this needs to be added into the orange column or taken out of the orange column, with the understanding we all have to understand the big picture and how that affects the bottom line. As we start increasing those things, we have to go back and look at the revenue factor and look at the fund balance factor and all those things. So everything is kind of all tied together, unfortunately.
Time and money.
Mr. Pendix.
I think the simplest way to put this for me, are there things here that you added or staff added that the principals or the teachers didn't ask for that you said, hey, no, you need this?
The only thing that comes to mind is the leveled readers. That's the only thing that we thought, you know what, more print in guided reading and balanced literacy is important. So that's the only thing on this list that was added. That's it. You're welcome.
All right, so any additional questions for key number two?
Me.
All right, so we're ready, I guess, to go to key number three. And
yes.
Again, Dr. Marzak, if you could remind us what key number three, what are we trying to accomplish there?
Students completing math and ELA on grade level by the end of sixth grade.
So
it's that checkup from key number one and key number two.
So it's both reading and math
English.
In some ways.
Reading and English and math, yeah, reading English and math, yeah.
In sixth grade. All right, so if you'll go through those requests for the board members.
So Mount Pleasant members. Middle School asked for an additional language arts instructor and a math instructor to reduce numbers. Those are currently sitting in the accelerate column because that's something that they would love to have. Mount Pleasant Middle School also asked for tablets for students doing Mayan and Dreambox, which is reading and mathematics. We were able to fund 25. We couldn't fund 150. Mount Pleasant Middle School also asked for a TN writing program. This would be a not computer based, but a pencil and paper based program where students could practice their writing to get better on TN Ready. It's only a cost of $3,900, so we move that over to the funded line item. Whitthorn Middle School asked for a dean of students. This was a position to help out with the tasks around the building. That currently sits in the accelerate column, but we were able to give Whitthorn help on this. One of the things that we discovered is, according to current enrollment numbers at Whitthorn, they should have 5 educational assistants. They only currently have 2. So we funded them 3 additional educational assistants because it's what they're supposed to have by current Tennessee funding levels. And so what was discovered in this budget meeting, which is great about having us all around the table, is those 3 additional EAs will be able to help with things around the building, which would then free the principal and the assistant principal up to do more instructional type materials as opposed to watching the cafeteria and types of things like that. So we were able to help them out with that one. Whitthorn Middle School and Spring Hill Middle School asked for an RTI instructor. Again, that's a split position. The best we could do because we had 3 middle schools that asked for. Santa Fe Unit School asked for 70 hours of tutoring for after school and during the summer. That moved over to the funded line item. They asked for Chromebooks. We were able to fund 25. We couldn't fund 126. Spring Hill Middle School also asked for Chromebooks for Mayan and Dreambox and 10 marks. We were able to fund 25. Hampshire Unit School asked for 45 Chromebooks. We were able to fund them through a previous key. Culioca Unit School asked for 40 Chromebooks. We were able to fund them at 25. We couldn't do 40. So there's still an additional $10,000 that if you guys wanted to move over, you could and give them more. And then Culioca Unit School asked for an RTI teacher for math and ELA. And this one is split because this person could do both elementary school and middle school. So they could do keys 1, 2, and 3 together. So I looked at that one as a 3-way split versus a 2-way split. So that person would be responsible for elementary and middle school RTI.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Marzak.
You're welcome.
All right, we open the floor for any questions regarding your request under key number 3. Mr. Lassiter.
For the 70 hours of tutoring at mm-hmm. Santa Fe.
Yes.
What did you use for the dollar amount for that per hour?
$25 an hour. Let's see if that comes out right. That's probably 2 positions.
Okay, that's why I was asking, because I know we had mentioned 25 an hour, and my math wasn't coming out that way, but.
Yeah, that's 2 positions.
Okay, so do we need to change that then to?
Done.
Was that the intent? It should be 2?
2 positions, yes.
Okay, and. For Hampshire Unit School, the Chromebooks, you said, where is that funded at? Because it's still showing
key number 56. or line 56.
Okay, so it's up in the next, it's up in the...
Yes.
So they're going to be sharing the Chromebooks for different classes?
Yes. Now, if you want to fund them, 25 for elementary school and 25 for middle school, we can do that. But that's a decision that's got to be made.
I know that it was still showing up in the maintain column, and that's why I was curious.
Gotcha.
Where that was, where because you had said that we're doing it, so.
Yes.
All right, so I need to put that down as being in line 56. All righty. Thank you.
Oh, and I'm sorry. That cost is, it's not 25 Chromebooks. That cost us 50 Chromebooks. 12,500 is 50 Chromebooks, not 25. My mistake. I'm sorry. So everywhere you see 12,500, that's 50 Chromebooks. Sorry, my mistake. They're 250 apiece. Yes, but they also asked for Chromebooks late, further on down.
So doesn't that kind of defeat the purpose of breaking this out by key? If they ask for them for a different key,
mm-hmm.
shouldn't we put that under the different key category? If
we can, if that's the way you want to do it, it was easier to group it and accumulate it into one key. That's the way it was easiest to do. That way, it's not like, well, why are we doing 4,000 here and 12,000 there and 6,000 here? So it was easier to accumulate it in one key. Simpler for organization, if you will.
All right.
All right. So, committee members, any additional questions under key number 3? Say no, ready to go to key number 4.
Key number 4.
If you'll remind us what that is.
Yes, students completing Algebra 1 by the end of 8th grade. Cox Middle School said that they needed a teacher in 7th and 8th grade to focus strictly on mathematics. That was moved over to the funded line item. They also asked for a site license for Odysseyware, which is a credit recovery software program. We currently have a credit recovery software program, so we'd be able to integrate them into that one as opposed to buying additional So that's why that one's left in the maintain. Mount Pleasant Middle School asked for an Algebra 1 transition instructor. That's still currently sitting in the maintain column. And from what I understand, that's a person that will help more students be ready for algebra by the time algebra hits at the end of 8th grade. Mount Pleasant Middle School asked for TI-84 calculators. That was moved over to funded. Santa Fe Unischool asked for Chromebooks for Dreambox and 10 marks. That was funded in a previous key. Spring Hill Middle School also asked for TI-84 calculators. That was moved over to funded. And Kaleoke Unit School needs an advanced math teacher to teach algebra and geometry. They currently don't have one in the middle school, and that's moved over to funded at $65,000.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Marzak. All right, so are there any questions by the committee members regarding the key number 4 requests? All right, seeing none, we're ready to go to key number 5. What is that?
Key number 5 is students meeting all of ACT college readiness benchmarks before graduation. So Mount Pleasant Middle School asked for additional money so that they could administer ACT more. That was moved over to funded. Mount Pleasant High School asked for a replacement of their current TI-84, their out of date and their older calculators. We were able to fund half of that at $7,500, but there's still another half to be funded that sits in the Accelerate column. Mount Pleasant High School asked for Scholastic Math 180. Dr. Gunn is saying that program ties into helping students on the ACT. That cost is $51,000. That still sits in the maintain column. Mount Pleasant High School also asked to have a rising freshman camp, which will help students get ready in order to meet those ACT college readiness benchmarks when they hit their freshman year. That was moved over to funded. Mount Pleasant High School asked to implement an ACT readiness program. That was moved over to funded. Spring Hill High School asked for a program called Achieve 3000. Achieve 3000 is a literacy-based program, and it's strictly for kids that are in Tier 3. Those are high school students that are severely behind with concern to language arts, and that program gets them caught up. So based on the current numbers that they have, Dr. Potts says they only need $8,000. It's an expensive program, but it also has data that shows that it works. So that was move it over to the funded program. Northfield is asking for an ACT teacher. That's currently sitting in the maintain column. We're almost wondering if we could share with Spring Hill High School and have a teacher share with Northfield. So we're exploring that. So that currently sits. Santa Fe Unit School asked for an ACT prep guide for 9th and 10th grade students. That was moved to funded. They also asked for an ACT online prep program that they would be able to put students in that would directly impact their ACT scores. That was moved into funded. Hampshire Unit School asked for Chromebooks. Those were funded in a previous line item. They also asked for the ACT practice test. That was moved over to funded at a cost of $140. Hampshire Unit School asked also for the online prep program, as there was asked for at Santa Fe. That was moved over to funded. Hampshire Unit School also asked to send teachers to training to implement ACT problem-type activities in the classroom. That was moved over to funded. Culioca Unit School asked for an advanced English teacher to impact ACT that sits and maintain. They also asked for an RTI teacher that sits and maintain, and they asked for ACT practice books, which are online tests and also the Pareto system, and that was moved over to funded. One thing I will let you know, as far as line 94 and line 95, we're having to balance the resources, physical resources we can put in Culioca due to size. They can only take so many teachers because Culioca is our largest growing school at this time. So if they get too many personnel, we may have to do portables. That's an additional added cost, and I don't know if we want to do portables at Culioca Unit School. They are out of room, and they're only growing even more. So they asked for a lot of personnel, and the question was, well, Penny, where are you going to put them? And she said, I got no idea. So just to let you guys kind of know that.
So you're hitting us with some future capital outlay issues. So,
yes, sir.
But we haven't got there yet.
Yes, sir. No, we're not there yet. No, we're only on the keys. Okay. That's all we're looking at.
All right. So, Mr. Moore, then Mr. Lassiter.
Okay. And I guess I'm kind of jumping ahead too here on the on all these Chromebooks.
Yes.
And the other devices. Obviously, I guess I have some concerns on the elementary level about devices in the hands of small children and
yes.
the I'm going to break it rate.
Yes.
What is that? I mean, I'm sure other schools have done this. What kind of replacement rate are we looking at? I mean, this is several hundred Chromebooks. How often are we going to be buying new ones to replace broken ones?
Tommy Schuyler's not here. So basically what we're looking at is we're replacing desktops with laptops is basically what we're looking at.
Okay.
I want to say that cost includes insurance. I mean, they're only $250 a piece, and they're internet books is basically what they are. Chromebooks have no hard drive. They just access the internet. Principals are saying, We can't get kids on Dreambox because we don't have enough.
Okay.
We need more to get kids on Dreambox. So,
well, I guess, like I said, so there's some insurance on that. So when I see second graders spin around in their eventual wheeled chairs that we're going to be putting in all these other schools,
and the conversation is, hey, we're noticing we gave you 50, you broke 35.
Okay.
What's going on here? So all of this is all when usage drops. Well, why are there less kids on Dreambox this month than there were last month?
Okay.
And so we start to have those conversations, and those conversations inform decisions about where we move forward.
Okay.
So.
And I think, thank you, Mr. Board, for bringing that up. That is something that we, I think, as a board need to start wrapping our minds around for the future. I know when we went to the school in North Carolina, that's something they developed some policies on what would happen if you lost or damaged your device. And so there's some ways of kind of getting the parents a little skin in the game so that maybe they try to encourage their children to take care of the devices, that sort of thing as well. So
I mean,
that may be something we need to be maybe already kind of mulling over some policies on some things.
One, like two, understandable. More than five or ten, that we have a management problem. And so what we got to look at is we got to look at how are you deploying those in the classroom? How are they moving around? Do we need to change that? That informs conversation.
Mr. Lester.
Sure.
Yes, do you have a microphone? Then you can't say anything. Yes, Mr. Lester. Come on.
Been in use for almost a year now. We've had five, we've had 10
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Mr. Lassiter.
On the TI-84s, what are we using cost per calculator? I didn't see a number there for how many they asked for, so.
Those notes are in my office. I can get those to you in the morning. I'll tell you what the cost is.
All right.
Sorry.
Before we leave tonight, too, remind me, I got some information that I need to give to you.
Hold on 1 second. Let me see. I wonder if we get a cost. Do we, Dave, have we ever bought TI-84s as a district?
Yes, we have. It's been over a year ago.
Do you know the cost per roughly? I want to say, how much? It's about a.
I mean, I know a couple of years ago you could buy, if you bought them as retail, if you bought them at the right time of year, you could get the SEs, the silver editions, for about $100. But I would hope that we would do better than that if we're buying in bulk.
Yeah, right now, I mean, online you can get a TI-84 plus graphing for $139. We'll get it a whole lot less than that because we buy in bulk.
Okay. Yeah, I just was curious.
And also no sales tax.
So that when we do, when we go through the line here, that I know what to put in.
I can get you that information. It's sitting in my notes in my office. I can get that for you.
All right, so are there any additional questions regarding key number 5 request? All right, seeing none, looks like we're ready to proceed to key number 6.
Key number 6 has a huge cost associated with it. Key number 6 is students financially literate by graduation, and we have no cost associated with that. We're taking care of that in-house. So currently what we have is we have 2 central office personnel that are currently developing an SREB online module. What we currently have is students in Tennessee have to take, and I'll explain that, students in Tennessee have to take a financial literacy class. It's a 9-week course. But what we've noticed is what the state of Tennessee is asking our kids to do is not very rigorous. So we've created our own online module. These 2 central office supervisors are getting together a group of community financial people to come in, analyze the module, give us feedback on whether we need to get more rigorous or we need to back off or what we need to add in. And then we're going to implement that online financial literacy module in the 9-week course. So we're actually going to take the state curriculum and we're going to amp it up and make it customized to Maury County Public Schools. And that cost is completely free.
Thank you, Dr. Marzak. Are there any questions regarding the committee members?
Free's good. Yeah.
We're going to have that the more line item that probably will get funded, I guess. So. All right, so key number 7, remind us again what key number 7 is.
So key number 7 is all students participating in AP, dual enrollment, industry certification, work-based learning, or military preparation by graduation. So as we start to move down here, first one, line number 100, jobs for Tennessee grads. That's currently a program that's worked on. The gentleman's name is John Dwyer. He's currently in charge of that program, and we currently have Tennessee grads, people working in our schools, but according to Mr. Dwyer, they can only impact so many kids. And these kids that are going for job for Tennessee grads, is these are kids that are in fear of not graduating, and he gets them to graduation, and he gets them jobs. So that directly impacts key number 7. There's an immediate release on that. So what he was asking for was three partially funded salaries at $15,000 apiece. He has federal and state grants that make up the rest of that salary. So he's looking to do 2 at Central, 1 at Spring Hill High School, and 1 at Mount Pleasant Middle School. So we currently have 4 sitting in the Accelerate column because we'd love to have 4, but if we could at least get 3, that would put 1 more person at CHS, 1 more person at Spring Hill, and 1 more person at Mount Pleasant High School. He also wants to eventually see how he can break into the unit schools. But right now, he currently only has plans, according to his state grant, for working with our big 3 in our county. So that's one of the things that he asked for. So 3 were moved over to the funded category because it's an immediate return on investment. Central High School, requested monies for an additional ROTC instructor, and if you'll know, we funded for the last 2 months. That person is currently here, and they're currently working. Central High School had to turn away 70 students from ROTC this year because they didn't have enough personnel. So I said, you know, Master Chief Edelman, write the Navy, see what they say. The Navy said, you got another instructor. After I got up from a slight coronary heart attack, because the ROTC is not giving additional instructors. I never thought it would be funded. I was like, just shoot. The worst I could say is no. And they said yes. So that's been moved over to funded at $20,000 a year. And we also get additional money from the U.S. Navy for that. In addition to that, one of the things that Master Chief Edelman made a covenant is, if we can get a third instructor, we'll implement the Discovery Education Navy STEM program. So they're going to be implementing that program, which is completely free through Discovery Education, about how they tie STEM jobs and STEM learning into careers in the Navy. So he's going to implement that as part of his program. Mechatronics instructors, this is the thing that that Dr. Brown informed you about at our last board meeting. So we would love to have mechatronics instructors at all six schools. You'll see that cost at $390,000. We have currently three at the big three, and we would seek to recruit students from Santa Fe or Hampshire or Culioca that wanted to come to the big three and participate in mechatronics. So we at least have three funded, as well as the hardware, the training, and the materials and supplies that go along with those requests at each one of those schools. You'll see that's a heavy cost, but I'll tell you that that's a huge investment into the industry that's coming into Maury County Public Schools. We're basically telling industry, come, we're preparing your future workforce. And this is a big commitment, and I think it's a commitment that's going to pay dividends. Moving down to line 06, Project Lead the Way. We have 13 schools. We have got all the elementary schools, 7 middle schools, and 6 high schools. All 13 of those Project Lead the Way instructors are funded in there. You'll also see that the training, the supplies, and the hardware are moved over to the funded line as well. Much like mechatronics, this pre-engineering program and current engineering program at the high school just basically gives more kids more opportunities to meet some of those engineering pathways and move into some of the industries that we currently have that are moving into Maury County Public Schools and Maury County. Mount Pleasant High School asked for additional money for bringing in more industry certification and doing more in dual enrollment. That was moved over to funded. They also asked for AP testing and teacher training so that they could offer more AP classes to more kids. That was moved over and funded. Spring Hill High School asked for AP instructors. They had originally asked for 4. They would like to have 2. We were able to move 1 over to be funded, so one giving them 1 additional AP instructor. I will tell you that we did fix one of the errors and one of the problems that we had at Spring Hill High School. Over the last couple of years, they've been gaining enrollment, but they've been losing instructors. So when we were in our budget meeting and Dr. Hargrove started crunching the numbers, according to the BEP, they should have had 6 additional teachers than they have now. And so we gave them their 6 additional teachers. Their numbers were over capacity, and they never should have been. So we fixed that problem. So in addition, they're asking for 1 additional instructor to strictly focus on AP. Those other instructors will be to relieve overcrowding and relieve large numbers in their general math, English, sciences, and social studies areas. They also asked for a work-based learning instructor. That's something they would like to have, but it's not a deal breaker if they don't. That's why it sits currently in the Accelerate column. They also asked for AP teacher training so that they can offer more AP courses in the future. That was moved over to funded. Northfield asked for money for NIMS certifications. What's NIMS again? I can't remember. Yeah, that one. National Incident Management System. And so basically, students would be able to get a certification in National Incident Management. And that's a cost of $450. So we moved that over to funded. Santa Fe asked for more Chromebooks for ACT prep. They're getting 50 Chromebooks in a previous funded line item, so that's still left at maintain. Spring Hill Middle School asked for a Spanish teacher, and it's kind of weird to see a middle school, but Spring Hill Middle School and Spring Hill High School have been talking, which I love collaboration, and what Shonda Sparrow and Dr. Potts have worked out is that we will get to a point where we'll be able to start offering high school credit in middle school for Spanish, and by the time they get to their freshman, sophomore year of Spring Hill High School, they'll be able to take AP credit in Spanish. And so they've worked collaboratively on that one. So that's why you see a middle school funded in a high school key, because they're working together on that. Hampshire Unit School wants to get into a health sciences career technical education path. But in order to do that, they need a CTE person in health sciences. So that was moved over to funded. And they also wanted to start an industry certification with agricultural pesticides. And so that cost is $250. We thought that was a good use to get more students, more industry cert. So that was moved over to funded.
Thank you, Dr. Marzak. All right. If the committee members have any questions, Mr. Lassner.
Couple questions here.
Yes, sir.
One, none of the other schools other than Mount Pleasant asked for money for AP testing?
No, sir.
And what plans do we have for this next school year to help with AP with Santa Fe, Calioka, and Hampshire?
I would have to talk to the principals at those three schools to see what plans we have.
Because I think that since you've been here, it's been brought up. But in the past, we've talked about doing distance learning and different mm-hmm. things like that. And I think another good, if we can get to that route, even if we could do that as soon as next year for some classes, you know, we have, for example, Summit right across the county line that offers 16 different AP courses if they get students in there. And I guarantee you that, like our schools, we have AP courses offered that they don't get enough students to fill the class. And, I mean, it would be great if we could do that. And even if we had to pay then, if we had to pay a facilitator to be, obviously somebody has to supervise the students.
Yes.
But if we could do that legally and we have a facilitator that watches our students, or maybe we have the AP teacher and they, you know, they have a facilitator at the other schools, then, I mean, I think that would be a great opportunity at a reduced cost. And we could do, if you guys can work it out, that would be almost an instant plus for the students that we have now. You know, because again, we lose these students. You know, next year, the ones that are juniors now, next year, if they can't get it, they're done. You know, the mm-hmm. ones that are sophomores now, you know, it's going to hurt them if they can't get that next year to mm-hmm. help get that done. So, I mean, I'd love to see us look into, you know, because I don't see any additions on here for AP for the three unit schools and. Mm-hmm. And, you know, not really enough for our other schools either. Like I said, if we could partner with some other groups, and I realize there may be definitely be either a trade-off or a cost associated with that, man, that'd be.
Well, a couple things play up here. First off, this is the first time as a community and as a school system that we've ever systematically focused on AP. We did it, we didn't. We've never focused on it. So this is year one. Because what we realize as we move down to all keys, we couldn't put this in here yet because it's going to take 3 years to get up to AP status. Because first kids have to have French 1, French 2, and then they can have French AP. So those two courses are a prerequisite to AP. So what I think is happening is some of the high schools are starting to align to eventually getting to the point where they need AP, and when that time comes, they're going to start to ask for it to get ready for it. But for some of these schools, it's going to be a 3 or 4 year process before they can get AP into place, because you have to have prerequisites to those courses, which are specific course code studies, which we probably may or may not currently offer. So this is just year one of us systemically and systematically focusing on it. This is the first stab. Next year, year after that, you're going to see more requests for more AP, more work-based learning, more industry cert, because we will make movements on key number 7 with these funded items. We will. I thought you were waiting for.
I thought you were contemplating your next question. Thank you, Mr. Leiser. Sure. I think Mr. Leiser brings up a good point when we're looking at the key number 7. Of course, you're getting in, these are the more expensive items.
Yes.
When I'm looking at all these keys. And so if there's any way that we can kind of get the most bang for our buck with some of these programs, if we do have, if we have constraints from a financial standpoint, that's something I would like to see as well, for us to, maybe we do not have the funding to have this particular advanced class at all the high schools.
Yes.
But maybe we do have the funding for one of the schools to be kind of the flagship. And then maybe all the other students at the other schools can participate in mm-hmm. that program with the distance learning or other technology that we may have, maybe that we're moving towards, where we can be kind of more virtual classroom type thing. And then we can maybe start really getting creative, where maybe it's a very advanced program that any of the schools really can't justify mm-hmm. because they would only have maybe 2 or 3 students that are even, you know, capable of that type of, you know, strenuous program.
Yes.
But there may be enough for the entire district to be able to participate, where we could have that program at one school and have all the other students kind of pull them together, so it is justified to hire one teacher for the entire district. So I would love for us to continue to kind of think down that path. And like you mentioned before, we're just year one, but yeah. as we go into year 2, 3, 4, maybe have that kind of in our back pocket a little bit of getting the most bang for our buck in case we do have that situation where maybe there's not an, it's not justified for one single school.
Yep. And I will tell you that Ms. Miller is researching online AP programs right now. Where students would, you know, take those in a web-based environment. We don't even need distance learning because it's all through video lessons and it's all through online learning. And so if that's something that comes down as a possibility that we could do when we move into a one-to-one environment and high school students all have a laptop device that they take back and forth between home and school, we'll be able to enroll them in those online AP programs through the learning management system that we go down and we do purchase as part of our one-to-one program. So we may be even be able to go one better than distance learning and move into online AP.
All right, so are there any additional questions regarding key number 7? Mr. Moore.
If we can go back, I don't have the line number here. Under the mechatronics, I just want to make sure yes. I'm looking at this correctly.
Yes.
Under the yellow column.
Yes.
The instructors, not though, just that was 6. Now that was to do all. That was to do 6 schools.
6 high schools. Yes.
So these items wouldn't be added together. They're completely separate. Correct.
They would be replaced.
Okay.
So yeah.
So if we just what you have it currently done is that we're funding 3 at the 195.
Yes.
If we were to, as a board, to decide to do all 6, we would remove the 195 and add in the 390. Is that what you're saying?
I believe that's correct. Yes.
Okay. Because I know some of the other line items in other places here were not replacement. They were additions. So we kind of went back and forth here.
And I think we left that as it was. So you would see the entire cost of what it would be. Dr. Brown and I collaborated on that. And she said, I would prefer you not change that to 3 and do 195. Leave it at 6 so you know the entire cost.
But some of the other ones are split up differently.
Some of the others are split up. Yes.
Done this way. Thank
yes.
you.
Intentionally.
Mr. Peaver.
Thank you. I think the mechatronics program, isn't that about the same type program that Huntsville City Schools have incorporated?
This is the program that's the collaboration with Columbia State, where the students would earn an associate's degree when they graduate from high school.
Mm-hmm. I know Huntsville City Schools here about 5 years ago, mm-hmm. they had a program similar to this. And, you know, they were having when they graduated a associate's program, but the businesses in Huntsville,
yes,
they got into the program.
Yes.
And they were offering scholarships.
Yes.
For these students to go to any college that they picked, be any type of engineer they wanted. The only thing they had to come back and work for them If I sent them to school for 4 years, I came back and worked with them for 8 years.
Yes.
Which is a win-win situation all around.
Yes.
And the technician programs that they had were that the students didn't want to go to college, that they came out with an associate's degree in electronics technician, and they went straight to work.
Yes.
With, you know, a higher pay than if they didn't have anything, you know.
Well, I'll also, since you broached the subject, I'll go ahead and let you know. So if this happens to get funded and we start to track the progress and students are making progress and we've got that data, I intend to work with the business community to start looking at sponsorships. So, for example, Columbia Machine Works, would you be willing to sponsor the program at Central High School and assume the costs moving here on out, which means we then save money and can put it into a different area? And it would be the Columbia Machine Works Mechatronics Program at Central High School. And the CEO of that company, John Langston, assumes all the funding. And so I am looking at approaching businesses once we have a track record of success to get them to adopt those businesses, slap their name on it, and it's their program in our schools benefiting their businesses and our families.
Yeah. And you know, from what I've seen in Huntsville, it is a very good program.
It is a very good program,
so,
yes, sir.
You know, I think if we could make sure we found a way to fund it.
Yes.
That our students, our future engineers, welders, whatever.
Yes, sir.
You know, would be an asset not only to for them, but also for our county.
Agreed.
Thank you, Mr. Beaver. All right, so we have Mr. Lassiter and then Mr. Moore.
I know our grant coordinator's not here tonight, but I was kind of curious. In the past, my son's senior year, so 2014, I know we actually had a grant where they were asking for their industry certification that he was able to do his AP and AT, his Net Plus and his AT, right? A plus, yeah. His Net Plus and his A plus, and a grant paid for the students to do that. So I would also hope that I know we're not going to put that in because that's a hopeful thing. But, you know, I hope that we can get some of those as well, because, again, we need to really, you know, even the to go through and do AP testing a couple of years ago was $85, I think, a test. So, which is great when you look at, then when they go to college, they're going to get credit for certain things if they score high enough on a test.
Yeah. Yeah.
But we have people that's a hardship for.
Yes.
So hopefully.
And we do get waivers for students that are on free and reduced lunch to take those courses and those classes at a reduced rate.
And when we get the waivers, then who pays their fees?
It comes out of our
budget for the free and reduced.
I think who reimburses? The state reimburses? Yeah. But I do want to let you know that these costs that you're seeing here are before we received information from Columbia State that we received the grant through the state of Tennessee for mechatronics. We could be reimbursed portions of this money. But this is full cost, as in we're doing it ourselves, and we're working with Columbia State. But remember, this only got off the ground as a result of a state grant to implement mechatronics in schools.
Right. And I think it's a good thing that we're assuming that we're going to have to pay the full cost, because if we get a grant, then that's just just a big help. But otherwise, yes, we may have to pay for all of it.
Yes, sir.
So thank you.
You're welcome.
Can we – I know we're just kind of skimming it tonight, but for later discussions, can we look at the – on the mechatronics, what is our expected for the three schools are currently that you have laid out to fund?
Mm-hmm.
What the expected per year number of students we graduate from that program, and then not tonight. I'm not asking for that. Can you have some numbers?
Dr. Brown to come back and give you a presentation? Do you want to ask specific questions that she can come back and present to you?
Just the numbers. Not tonight.
Make a note of that?
Again, not tonight. But right. If we could just on the three schools, and then also for the six schools.
Yes.
If we were to expand it, what kind of numbers are we talking about of being able to realistically have actually complete and come out of the program with the full accreditation?
We can give you tentative numbers, but I will go ahead and tell you, at Central High School's freshman sign-up, they had a mechatronics table, and kids were coming over and asking about it, what they needed to do. Dr. Brown was telling them, we want to offer it, but it hasn't passed the board yet, so we're not sure if we're going to have it. Kids were moving on. So the numbers may be kind of low because right now we're not saying that we have it. So kids aren't signing up for it. Because if they sign up for this, but they wanted to do that, and they don't get into that, they get into this, and we don't get it, they don't get into that.
Well, I guess
that makes sense.
Numbers-wise, I was thinking more of looking at other systems.
Okay.
On a per, like if you have a 10,000 student system and you've got this
how many
in
kids?
The schools, how many kids are sure. are they actually graduating out of that system per year?
Sure, we can find that out.
Because what I'm looking at here is just what are we getting for this money at the end of the day?
Understandable.
Some realistic numbers. And I do, it, again, not just the three schools. I'd like to see the numbers for the, yeah. the full, if we were to do for the whole thing.
And you won't see graduates for four and a half years.
Sure, which is why I'm saying we'd need to look at systems that have had this in place and at the, you know, a few years into it, what are they actually coming, what's the output?
Good point.
Any additional questions regarding key number 7? All right, looks like we're ready to move on to the next category. So I guess it's kind of a catch-all that deals with all keys.
Yes, and these are things that were that principals presented or were part of that didn't fit a specific key, but they hit multiple keys. So that's why we kind of have this one. So the first one is reclassifying the coordinator here at Horace O. Porter to a high school assistant principal program. This program, Alternative School, runs as a program of Central High School, but the person that runs it's a coordinator. It really should be an assistant principal program because it's a program of. And so that cost is $5,000, and we moved that over to the funded line item. Horace O. Porter also asked for a full-time sub or an EA, somebody that can move in and out of classrooms, relieve if a substitute teacher doesn't show up. You may be surprised. The alternative center sometimes has a problem getting subs, and subs take it or don't show up or don't take the job at all. So if they had that floater, then they'd be able to fill in for positions that were out as opposed to splitting. Murray Alliance, Mary Beth West, there was a request to move into greater work with Murray County Public Schools. You know they've been working with the Murray Alliance to move into a greater work and have them doing even more promotion for Murray County Public Schools. The Grow Murray campaign has grown. Chairman Bates has been to a couple of those meetings. They were requesting $50,000. I saw that we could possibly fund $30,000 and $20,000 stayed in the maintain column. But their entire request was $50,000. Riverside Elementary School asked for a behavior specialist, somebody to work with their kids. They have some students that are challenging. And so we left that. We have that in the accelerate column, but we do know that that will be a function of the new supervisor of counseling and mental health to start to work with the principals to bring community resources in to help students with academic needs and behaviors. So that's one of the reasons why that's currently sitting in the accelerate column. Mount Pleasant High School asked for a foreign language teacher. Again, this didn't fit specifically into the AP key because it's going to be 3 years before this person's going to be offering AP, but they at least start the process now. So that was moved over to funded. Northfield currently doesn't have a secretary or a clerk. Diane answers the phones, meets with kids, goes and picks up lunches. If she's not at her desk, the phone doesn't get answered. And so so she needs somebody to answer the phone while she's meeting with students or doing what she needs to do. So we move that over in the funded line. Randolph Howell asked for a dean of students position. They're growing in enrollment. So that's currently sitting in the accelerate column. Hampshire Unit School asked for a pre-kindergarten teacher. They see pre-kindergarten as a necessity and a need in their community. Those two positions combined make up $90,000. Those are currently sitting in the maintain column. There has been an ask for an elementary Gen Ed Academy, students that are not identified with specific learning disabilities or handicaps, but have behavioral problems. There's been an ask for a place for those students to go to work on their behavior. Again, we see that as a component of the new supervisor of counseling and mental health to help with that. So right now that sits in the accelerate column. There's also the same ask at the middle school level. Students that don't hit an IEP, don't have special needs, but do have behavioral problems. So that currently sits there as well because we see that as a function of the new supervisor of counseling and mental health. Transportation, bus drivers. This is something that, Mr. Breen's going to be talking about, lowering our walk zones down to 0.0. And if that's something that the board wants to get to, if you guys want to move down to that, I understand, and Mr. Breen may be able to elaborate more on this, but that cost to lowering walk zones to zero would require at least 3 bus drivers and possibly 7 at a cost of $60,000 and $140,000. Mr. Breen?
Let me just interrupt. Actually, the walk zones is 7. The 3 bus drivers are 3 additional substitute drivers we're requesting, Dr. Marzak.
Oh, that's right, with the 5 additional buses. Yeah. Okay, I'm sorry, my mistake.
Because
correct.
We actually moved some of our substitute bus drivers into full-time route roles this year, so we're down 3. We're only at 7 substitutes, and typically we've had 10. But the 7 additional bus drivers would be to provide for the walk zones. So it's the 3 is in the needed column, the 7's if we wish to go to
0.0
walk zones.
Parent responsibility zone.
Right.
Kaleoke Union School asked for academic tutors for both math and ELA for K-12. That currently sits in the maintain column. The Murray County Teacher Center has 2 requests. They reached out to me, and I was impressed. I didn't even think about the Murray County Teacher Center, but they impact the Keys every single day with the work that they do for teachers, the things that they run off, the instructional materials they supplied. So the first thing they asked for was a full-time secretary, because there's currently only 2 people that are there. So if one person's out and about and somebody goes and rings the buzzer, there's nobody to get the door. So that was an interesting request. That's currently set to maintain. But there was a request to upgrade. So there's 2 people in there, and one of the people is currently listed as a part-time clerk. But really the work she does is of a teaching role. She teaches technology courses. She teaches other types of courses to teachers, and she has the ability to do it. So upgrading her from a part-time clerk to a part-time teacher, saw that as a critical upgrade and a critical funding, because that's a person we don't want to lose that has a specialized skill. So that moved over to funded at $25,000. Catapult Education is the current program that I kind of told you about with my ERDI presentation that would work with overage middle schoolers and students that are having tough adjustments to fitting into the general normal school structure. Cox is having some difficulties with these types of students. This is something that Dr. Webb has identified as a need. $250,000, the entire cost of the whole contract is over $500,000. And so my request was, year one, let's split that in half and see the kind of work that they do at half cost. So $250,000 is in the funded column and $250,000 is in the maintained column.
Thank you, Dr. Marzak.
You're welcome.
All right, so we're getting closer to the budgeted time of 8 o'clock. So what we're going to do, I'm going to open up the floor. We're going to go ahead and finish up any questions that we have for all keys, and then we'll take a break until Wednesday to come back
yes,
with
sir.
The rest of these items. So I'm going to open the floor for questions regarding the all key section. Looks like we have Mr. Pennings and then Mr. Lassiter.
Yeah, it's for Mr. Breeden or Dr. Marzak. What's a 0 walk zone?
Let me go.
Go ahead.
The currently, if students live within a mile and a half of the school, a circle around the school, then they are required to provide their own transportation to school. This would move it down so that every student would have the right to ride the bus to school.
Okay, that's all that means then, because in our policy, if you want us to change like our policy, to have our policy state a 0 walk zone, well, if a child lives at 1614 Annie Lane, he gets picked up at 1614 Annie Lane. If he lives at 1620 Annie Lane, he would get picked up at 1620 Annie Lane?
That does not necessarily address the bus stops. Currently in our policy, we also have the fact that bus stops can be up to 6/10 of a mile from the child's home. The policy has both the 1.5-mile walk zone and 6/10 of a mile for the bus stops. We would propose by doing this that we'd be able to also reduce, or we would also be able to broaden our number of bus stops so that we could offer, in most cases, at their door pickup. There's some places where that's not practical because the way of neighborhoods are made and that kind of things, but in most cases we'd be able to do that.
Thank you.
Question on the Murray Alliance line.
Mm-hmm.
On the screen, you're showing 20 and 30.
Yes.
On ours, it shows 50. You know, ours was not updated to that, so that's what you would like for us to do is to,
yes,
the 20 and 30?
Yes.
And my other question was going to be for the Kaleoka academic tutors.
Yes.
So those are 75,000 apiece?
65,000.
Okay. All right. Yes. All righty. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Mr. Beaver.
All right. Thank you. Now, as our schools grow, and one of the things that I didn't see in here, mm-hmm, was counselors.
Yes.
Do have we took a look at how our counselors are?
According to Dr. Hargrove, when we looked at personnel, schools were currently adequately funded for counselors.
All of them?
From what I understand from the meetings, yes, that is correct. If there were any that she had to look at, she made a note and she got back with that principal at a later time. I don't remember counselors ever coming up from a principal.
Can we talk after?
Of course we can.
Okay. All right. Thanks, sir.
You're welcome, sir.
Mr. Morrison.
Earlier tonight, you showed us a page of expected revenues and expected expenditures.
Yes, sir.
Out of the expected expenditures, I assume that you went through and looked at all of our teacher positions throughout the county. Were there any teaching positions that you found that were unnecessary that you were able to cut?
No, sir.
Okay. And then through all keys,
Actually, we're underfunded with teaching positions, hence Spring Hill High School.
Okay. With all keys, then, I'm seeing at least, and because I'm only counting lines, but some lines have more than one position, but I'm seeing 66 to 70 new teaching positions, tutoring, mm-hmm, positions, and so forth. Is that?
Some of these teaching positions won't need classrooms. An RTI teacher won't need a classroom. They'll push into classrooms, or when this classroom's vacant, they'll work with these kids. So we're not looking at additional. The only positions that would need a place would be the art teacher, the music teacher at Marvin Wright and Spring Hill Elementary School. We would only need places for those, and the principal said yes, we have a place for those. Okay.
But RTI teachers need a place to take the students.
Well, they could push into the classroom. So, for example, during the course of the day, the teachers split up and they do what's called RTI time. So it's split up according to the kids that need intervention and the kids that need enrichment. So that would be an additional body that would be in there, making those intervention and enrichment groups smaller so that they'd be able to be more targeted instruction with kids.
Okay.
So they'd be in the classroom or in flexible learning environments.
So would any of these new teaching positions, RTI positions, whatever, be BEP positions?
No. No, sir.
Thank you.
Mr. Dudley.
Thank you. You told us earlier in the year that you were planning on having two schools, Spring Hill High School, and I don't remember which other one was going away from block scheduling.
Yes, sir. Santa Fe Unit School.
Okay. What kind of effect is, always before the board members have been told that with block scheduling, we have more teachers than what BEP funds. What kind of effect is transitioning to the traditional schedules going to do as far as personnel?
According to Leanne Willie and Dr. Christine Potts, none. Zero effect.
Okay, Mr. Lassiter, and then Mr. Pennings.
And along the lines of going off the block,
mm-hmm,
we've also always been told, which it makes sense to me, that if we go off block, that we're going to have more, if we're using textbooks, which we're not at one-to-one yet, mm-hmm, then we're going to need more textbooks at those particular schools.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't remember, and I could have missed it, but I don't remember seeing a large bump anywhere for textbooks. What's the plan for that?
So the push of our current principals is to get our teachers away from using textbooks. Let's stop letting publishers tell us how to teach our kids, unless let's collectively collaborate on implementing resources in the classrooms to help students learn what they need to learn in order to be successful. So that's currently where we are. Now, with AP and things like that, there's really not much that you can do. If you have an AP foreign language course, you have to buy the AP foreign language book. But as far as the other classes are concerned, our principals are getting our teachers to move away from using textbooks to drive instruction.
And so you feel comfortable they're going to be ready to do that beginning of next school year?
They've been working on it, from what I understand, for years to get teachers away from using textbooks in the classroom.
Okay, are we going to be ready to do that at the beginning of the next school year?
Yes, sir.
Because, you know, and like I said, it does make sense that right now you've got, for example, say freshman math, while sophomore math, you would have half of the kids taking math, you know, part of the year and the other half the other. Now they're all going to do it all year long. So I just hope there's not a big pushback, because I know that, you know, while on one hand people are tired of seeing their kids lug all these books around, on the other hand,
yes,
I mean, I just had parents tell me over the weekend that, you know, their kids weren't, you know, they didn't bring home books, so if they needed to do work, there weren't take home books for them to do their work with.
And that's another reason why we're integrating programs like Mayan, Dreambox, and 10Marks, because those programs help students learn mathematical skills outside of using a textbook.
But I know we talked about the issue before. They're going to be able to take that home and work on that at home if they don't have internet connections at home. Are they going to be able to? Are we going to provide them with?
All three of those programs have printoutable materials that students can take home. You're going to pay one way, or you're going to pay the other.
Well, I understand.
If there was an easy way around doing it, somebody would have figured it out by now, and everybody would be doing it.
And that's part of where I was. Okay, so if we're going to print material out to take home, then. Is that in a budget somewhere where now our printing cost and all that are going to go up because, you know, we're not buying more books, but we're going to use more paper, more ink, more printer?
Well, one of the things Dr. Birkins is looking at is we're looking to move to a collective and collaborative purchasing agreement, not only for general office supplies and things in the classroom such as paper, but also copiers. Right now, schools have been responsible for securing their own copiers. And so we have leases all over the place, some high, some low, some medium, some outrageous, some awesome. And so we're actually looking at moving into, start phasing that out and start leasing that stuff as a district and getting massively reduced costs, which then we can absorb those costs for copying into what we were currently paying piecemealed. And so we're getting down that process. That hasn't been the way, but it's going to be the way from here on out. And schools realize, as we sat in the budget meeting, schools realize, you know what, if I bought pens in bulk, I could actually save money and buy more pens, as opposed to just going to Walmart or going to Office Max and buying pens. So we're getting down to that process. It's kind of like mowing. Schools shouldn't have to mow. So.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, if you just allow me a little latitude, seeing normally we're further along in this process, and I realize why we're not this year, and I don't have a problem. Dr. Marzak, in the orange column, you have reoccurring costs and one-time costs as your final.
Yes.
So the reoccurring costs are the costs that we would have to have year after year after
yes.
year after year.
Yes.
To do this. Yeah, thank you.
And as we get further along and we get down to that, I'll explain that. And what that means and why that's there when we get to that point.
And I'll be here Wednesday, and I'll probably be calling whenever I get phone service, and I got to hide this in my suitcase. So I appreciate it. Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right, so are there any additional questions regarding the all key section? Dr. Marzak, could you maybe go back to the catapult education and give me a little bit better understanding? I may have fell asleep at the wheel a little bit.
It's okay.
What that program does.
So those are actual people that come in and they operate what's called a school inside of a school. So there'll be catapult people that are working with our most highest need students at Cox Middle School to get them on the path to graduation. Because research says if you fail school once at any time during your academic career, your chances of graduating high school are about, dropping out of high school are 80%. If you fail twice, 92%. If you fail three times, 98%. We have some kids in middle school that have already failed twice. I mean, we have one student, Riverside, that's in fourth grade that's supposed to be in sixth grade. We have overage high school students. These people come in and they work to get those kids on a path to graduation. Because if we don't intervene with them, they will not graduate and they will impact not only our culture, but also our graduation rates moving down the path. So that's what Catapult does. It's a psychologically based driven company where they work with students to rewrite their academic DNA to get them back on the path to graduation, which then will impact Spring Hill High School because those students from Cox go to Spring Hill.
And don't get me wrong, I think
it's okay.
our vision is educating every child.
Yes.
And so we have to stay focused on all children, even ones that maybe it's been a little bit difficult to kind of keep their attention in the classroom.
Yes.
And maybe there's disruptions. And I'm all about that.
Yes.
I guess what I'm looking at is kind of the bottom line of $250,000 is one of the most, that's one of the largest line items on the entire board.
Yes.
And some of these other keys that we're leaving off, we're saying, okay, we're not funding academic tutors in math.
Yes.
For students that may be really interested in trying to do well in math or trying
yes.
to do well in reading, and they just need some additional assistance. So it's almost like you got a willing, able, and ready some of those items that we're not potentially funding, but then we're spending a large investment.
Yes.
And again, I recognize those needs. I just the comparison, I guess.
And that $250,000 will get us probably about 20 students. The entire amount gets us about 45 students.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right. So are there any additional questions regarding the all keys section? Okay, as I indicated earlier, what I would like for us to do is a budget about 2 hours at each meeting, just so we're still fresh when we're going through these numbers. Sometimes it can be a little bit tedious, but I do want to respect the interests of the committee members. And if somebody feels strongly that they want to plow on and finish up the keys budget, I'm certainly willing to do that. So I do want to hear from the committee members. If anybody has any objection, if not, I would ask for a motion to adjourn.
I have a question real quick, Mr. Chairman. How do you want us to handle minutes? Do you want us to have minutes from tonight prepared tomorrow morning?
That would be my preference.
Sent to you guys and then we approve them?
Yeah, that would be my preference. But, you know, again, as I mentioned earlier, this is a work session type format.
Yeah.
And so I guess the committee could choose to suspend some of those formalities with the minutes.
Okay.
But we certainly, we definitely need to keep minutes.
We are.
Especially when we get into the stage when we're going to start taking up motions by the committee to
yes.
either say yay or nay on some of these things and what stays, what goes. So we definitely need to be keeping minutes at those meetings.
Well,
so,
next week it's a little tricky because we have Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. And
right.
so that could be a little bit tricky. So if you could give us some guidance on how you like to have minutes done,
okay, I will.
We'll comply with that.
Yeah, I'll certainly get with Dr. Birkins and you to where we can get those on the fast track.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. Any additional questions by the board or by the committee? Mr. Moore.
I was just saying I'm ready to keep going, but it seems like nobody else does. So.
That's a very good point, Mr.
Still Morrison. Ready to keep going.
Morrison. Are you going to be strenuously objecting if we go ahead and adjourn, though?
I think it was strenuous.
Okay.
Mildly annoyed.
Mr. Moore, I will make a motion to adjourn.
Okay. We have a motion by Mr. Penning, second by Mr. Morrison. All those in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Let the record reflect, or the minutes reflect, the vote was unanimous. So, okay. All right. So we will be coming back.